Thank you. Thank you already for that nice introduction. I hope everybody enjoyed lunch. I hope it wasn't too heavy, because I also going to tell a story, meaning that if you have a heavy lunch and a fairy tale story, you will fall asleep probably, so that's not really the goal of my presentation. My presentation, Incident Response in the Cloud, Foggy with a Ray of Sunshine. It's an original title, no? It is. Well, actually, there's also a story behind that title. It was during the summer that most of you maybe notice it, but I'm a sporty guy. And I have a flexible job, meaning I do my cardio in the mornings. And I was walking in the morning, and it was actually a week full of cloud security incidents. And we didn't find any logs, we didn't find any evidences, so it was really a little bit, searching in the dark. And I was walking in the morning, and I was like, the fog was coming, and then the sunshine, and I was like, this would be an awesome title, Foggy with a Ray of Sunshine, for Incident Response in the Cloud. So that's actually how we came up with that title. So our objective of today: can you automate incident response in Azure? I hope the answer is yes, because otherwise we are wasting 1 hour of our time. So let's hope that it's yes. And a short introduction about me. I'm Jeroen van der Leur. It's a difficult name to pronounce, I know. I think my parents never thought that I would present internationally, so it's not my fault, it's my parents' fault for that name. And I'm the service line manager at Enviso for cyber architecture and cloud security. Always remember to mention digital security, because when I come to a reception in a black suit with a red tie and I say I'm here about the security meeting, I probably end up somewhere at the door bouncing some guys away, so that's not my intention. I'm not a physical security expert. Some other facts: I consume a lot of chickens per year. The formula is below, you can look it up. And I also, when I'm not working or not with my family, I'm 6 days a week at the gym. I skipped leg day in the beginning, that's also why I cut off my legs there, so. So yeah, enough about me. Let's go through the agenda of today. First of all, we're going to start with a little story, once upon a time. Then we're going to look at security monitoring within the cloud. And eventually, if that visibility is increased, so if you have security monitoring, how you can actually automate within your security operations centers, so how you can automate incident response. And of course, we have a demo, so the last chapter is demo time. So let's start. Maybe also I forgot to mention, I have a 5-year-old son, and I have to tell every evening a once upon a time story, so I find it ideal to also implemented in or integrated in my presentations. So once upon a time, we had a client that was actually asking upfront, we are going to migrate towards Azure. We are going to move our on-prem data center towards a cloud environment. Can you actually help us with the security, with the controls? Can you see if it's actually secured by design? And provide some recommendations. As you already know, I work for Enviso. We are consultants. And consultants, they never say no to a question, right? So in this case, we also said, of course we can help. Let's do a design review. You have several models where you can base your design reviews on. But we use the CIS benchmarks and a Microsoft NIST blueprint model for this specific review. And what's really amazing about this case is that the client came upfront before he even migrated towards Azure. So it was actually in the design phase that we were involved as a security party. And in total, we found 12 issues and provided 9 high recommendations. So, and those recommendations are typically seen in multiple cloud environments within multiple organizations. So a subset of those recommendations are, I know it's 2019, almost 2020, but multi-factor authentication is still a struggle. And we recommended, okay, try to implement that multi-factor authentication, especially for your privileged accounts. Because you are moving from an on-prem environment towards a cloud environment that is exposed over the internet, well, multi-factor authentication, strong authentication is really a high recommendation. Also, I don't know how many of you have firewalls in your on-prem network. So a firewall that is filtering. Who has a firewall? Corporate, who has a firewall at home? Ah, even better, that's great. So if you have a firewall at home, if you have a firewall at corporate level, you have to have a firewall at cloud level. And you have some concepts there. Network security groups, for example. Network security groups, there you can filter your traffic and you can enable it per object. So try to use that. Do not expose all your ports on the internet because you will get attacked immediately after you expose that server. Another one, and the third one is actually an important one, but difficult to implement in many cases. Use role-based access controls, meaning that you have a central authentication in place. Because I actually don't know why in so many organizations I see that they are migrating to the cloud or that they are installing cloud servers, and they just click next, 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 and in one of those dashboards, there is username, password. They give in a username, they give in a password, and they give it to everybody within the company saying, hey, you can manage that server via that user. Well, that's not really how it's done. So use those role-based access controls. They are there for a reason. And a fourth one, also very important, enable Azure logging. Activity logs, network security group flow logs, SQL server logs, so that you can actually see what is going on within your cloud environment. I don't think those are really standard recommendations. Client was also satisfied. I think those are the basic ones. So the client was satisfied. But 2 months later, we got an urgent call. And you see the woods with the nice fog and the sunshine, it was actually burning. So the client asks us, well, you did a professional review. We paid you for your consultancy services. How the hell could this happen? And we were also surprised, like, that's really something strange. Let's take a look at this. So, dear client, give us your design, because we actually proposed, okay, this is a best practice design based on a NIST model. So give us the actual design that is implemented. And here's a challenge. I also did it with my son, find the 7 differences. In total, he found 18 differences or something like that. So we had a design based on our review, where we actually segmented everything via network security groups. We had a front-end layer. We had a domain controller subnet, because they still were using domain controllers, which is also best practice. We have a management subnet, and we have our app services and our containers, our database segment, all protected by those network security groups. So normally, access is limited. How they implemented the design, because they were talking about agile and flexible and things need to move. So they actually created the subnets, but everything was exposed to the internet. So yeah, not a good idea, because after, I think it was 3 hours, the first server was compromised. Yeah, that's actually, it's based on a true story. I hope nobody recognizes this, but it's based on a true story. So there you have it. We know our environment is vulnerable. We know it's exposed. We know attackers can compromise that environment. So it happened. So next step, okay, let's analyze what actually happened within that environment. And for that, we need logs, of course. So, dear Mr. Client, please can we have a look at the logs so that we can see what happened and that we can create a timeline and see what the actual impact is of the breach. First, network security group flow logs to detect the origin and the impact on the systems. Well, there were no network security groups, so you definitely cannot configure flow logs without network security groups. Also, within that environment, there was a database with confidential data related to personal information. So, dear Mr. Customer, give us the SQL audit logs so we can see which queries were performed. Nope. We couldn't see that. There were no SQL audit logs. Sensitive data was lost, probably, but we don't know which data actually. Azure AD sign-ins. So which users were impacted to see if malicious connections were actually using Active Directory accounts? Well, they all had a local account configured on their server, so we needed to retrieve for every server the sign-in logs locally, and also those were rotated, so there was no role-based access, meaning everything was actually separated from each other. So it was a hell of a job to actually concatenate all those information or all those sign-ins. And then system logs, yeah, system logs are always there. The actions that were performed on the systems, we can actually view them via the system logs. They were locally, but again, servers were rebooted because they were doing weird things. Yeah, that's true. Reboot, logs gone. Rotation size, logs gone. So there's only one conclusion. It was the most, no, it was actually the most limited report I had to write. I did it with an image. Assume everything is breached. We cannot really say that part of your network was safe because we don't have any visibility. We know it's vulnerable. So yeah, you need to assume everything is breached. So there goes our fairy tale. And it's not the only case. So just to put it in perspective, SANS did a cloud security survey this year, and 90% of the respondents actually confirmed that unauthorized access was in their cloud. So they had unauthorized access occurred within their cloud environment. Also, we have an incident response hotline, and we see an immense increase in cloud security incidents. So the last 2 months, we already investigated 9 cases that were specifically focused on cloud environments. So it is increasing, and it remains actually increasing. So we have, for the upcoming months, a lot of work, actually. And what were the main challenges during all those incidents? Well, actually, I will repeat myself over and over again, I'm guessing, but traffic filtering and logs. So traffic is not filtered in most cloud environments. They have those capabilities, but clients forget, or IT administrators forget to implement them, or they just assign a public IP and they think, ah, this works, nice, so let's continue. Default logging that's available. In many cases, we discuss logs on-prem, and then we discuss logging in the cloud. A lot of customers or a lot of people are actually thinking that default logging is enabled in the cloud, and it's actually the responsibility, for example, of Amazon, of Microsoft, to provide those logs. Well, no, not all logs are default, are enabled by default. Log retention period, also an important one, because they have a massive amount of resources, because they have a massive amount of systems, they define the log retention period in many cases for you. So 90 days, for example, is somewhere is actually defined in a lot of logs as the retention period. But what if you have an incident that occurred 90 days before those 90 days? So you cannot actually find the actual root cause. Access management, I already explained. Most of them are using with local user accounts and groups. Insecure host configurations, meaning they install a system, they let it run, the application is running, and update and patch management. It's not necessary in the cloud, apparently, so they don't do it. Or management ports are exposed on the internet. Those things we typically see that are wrong, or antivirus installations, anti-malware, endpoint detection capabilities that are not configured, so that are insecure host configurations. And in one particular case, and that was even worse, We had even issues to identify who was the resource owner of a specific resource that was compromised. Meaning we came in and they said, this server is compromised. And okay, we analyzed the traffic and we saw indeed it was doing crypto mining, it was doing brute force attacks against other companies, it was doing a lot of nasty stuff. And then we said, okay, but what was the original functionality of that system? Well, we don't know. We actually even don't know who configured that device and who actually started that device. So the problem with cloud these days, if you have enough privileges, you can actually spin up everything you want. So identification of your resource owners is also important, and role-based access can help you also with that one. So I think the main conclusion is, yeah, maybe a small remark. I try to use cute cat memes, but for some kind of reason it doesn't work with me, so I bring my dear friend BA. We need to do better, and you promised a ray of sunshine. So let's look what is possible, security monitoring in the cloud. So within cloud you have many features, and for me also, I'm actually focused on cloud environments. It's becoming difficult to keep up with all those tool sets. But here is a small overview of Microsoft Azure and Amazon AWS. And I aligned them vertically to see, because they have similar functionality. So identity and access management within Azure, you have your Azure AD logs. Azure AD logs, they do successful sign-ins, failed sign-ins, they map suspicious IPs towards sign-ins, so you can find that over there. IAM policy, you can configure an IAM policy to have fine-grained access within your AWS environment. And there also, you can actually see failed sign-ins, successful sign-ins, so it's logged over there. Then you have Security Center and CloudWatch, which actually increase security visibility within your cloud environment. So Security Center, for example, you already have it in a free tier. It will give you recommendations. It will state, okay, you didn't apply, for example, a network security group on a specific object. And CloudWatch, there you can actually create use cases, alerts, in case something happens. Then you have network security flow logs, which are actually going to look at what is coming in, what is going out. VPC flow logs, the same principle, but then for Amazon, for your virtual private cloud. Unified audit logs, and that's a weird one, but Microsoft is working on that. So your unified audit logs, if you have, who has Office 365? Who uses Office 365? By default, you don't have almost any logging, because this one by default is disabled. And it's just one button that you have to click, you don't have to pay extra, but the unified audit logs, they will actually say, okay, that user did this in this specific software as a service or in this specific application. So unified audit logs is actually a very interesting resource, especially for incident response, and we find a lot of information there. Same with CloudTrail. CloudTrail will do the management, so calls to management APIs and similar things, they will log it. And then you have the advanced capabilities, which you will also pay for. So you have the ATP logs, you have Office 365, ATP, you have Azure ATP, and you have, for example, for your workstations, you have Windows Defender ATP logs. Now you have also Windows Defender for your servers. And the same with GuardDuty. What makes it specific, the ATP and the GuardDuty or similar, they're all based on threat intel provided by Microsoft and Amazon. So they combine their threat intel with your logs to see, okay, is something suspicious going on? So you see, we have a lot of logs here. They are also listed. I will not go over them in detail. You can find them also online. But I just made a remark, okay, for example, activity logs, it's everything that is performed on resources, meaning if you create a new container, a Docker container, it will be shown in your activity logs. Default, they are on, 90 days, you have them. Diagnostic logs, what are you doing within that container, for example? They are not on by default, so you don't see what's actually going on in your container. Azure AD reporting, if you have a free or a default license, you have sign-ins for 7 days. So hopefully you detect incidents very fast. And you have Active Directory premium licenses, premium 1 and premium 2, 30 days and 90 days. So there you have a larger set of days available for logging. Virtual machines and cloud services. It's also manual activation is required, and auto-deploy is not by default. If you configure auto-deploy, every server that you're going to spin up is going to get an agent installed on it. So then Windows event logs and monitoring is actually performed on that system by default. Sorry. Then Azure Storage Analytics. Not enabled by default. NSK Flow Logs, not enabled by default. Application Insights, so actually for specific application monitoring, not enabled by default. And Security Alerts, well, they are not enabled by default. The recommendations, they are. And for the Security Alerts, you have to buy an additional license. So, what do we have in AWS? AWS CloudTrail is enabled by default, 90 days. AWS Config, actually to monitor configuration changes on your system, is not enabled by default. Amazon S3 Access Logs is also not enabled by default. And in many cases, we needed them because we wanted to see which data was breached. So if you don't enable them, you cannot see which data actually was breached within that S3 bucket. Amazon VPC Flow Logs, also not enabled by default, so you don't see what's coming in and going out in your network. Amazon CloudFront Access Logs is some kind of reverse proxy. There, it's a central point to actually gather your logs. It's also not enabled by default. Database logging, not enabled by default. And Elastic Load Balancing, also not enabled by default. So you see, you have a lot of options, but you need to configure it. That's what they call the shared responsibility model. You are responsible for that configuration. So you have those options, take a look at them, and configure them if you are using one of those cloud environments. But you also see we have a lot of logs. So how do you manage all those logs? Well, that's quite easy in the cloud because the cloud is scalable also from a log perspective. So you have something called Log Analytics Repository, and there you can, it's a structured way of storing data, and there you can actually configure agents that you deploy on systems. You can actually configure cloud services that are providing input towards that Log Analytics repository, and also API calls or API calls that are pushing information towards that Log Analytics repository. Above you see it's actually just a structured table, and you can run queries on it. And from those queries you can even create dashboards. What you can do with those dashboards, or what you can do with those queries, you can generate alerts. You can even forward them towards your on-prem scene, or you can export them to a CSV file for further analysis. So you have a lot of options, but they need to be in that Log Analytics repository. And also you're defeating their hard retention policy of 90 days, because here you can actually say, okay, I want to keep them longer, or I want to offload them to a storage account. For example, Security Center, I don't know, has anybody ever used Azure Security Center, or yeah, a couple of you? Well, Security Center is actually a dashboard built on a Log Analytics repository. So in case you are moving towards Azure and you want to use those features, if you put all your logs in one Log Analytics repository, you are already prepared for all those new features, because you just have to couple them or integrate them with that repository, and the logs are there. Same for Amazon, AWS. So there you have your S3 logs, your VPC logs. You also have agents that you can install on your systems. And there you have Amazon CloudWatch. You can create Lambda functions on that and push them to an Elastic stack. And there again, you can create custom dashboards. You also have the Security Hub from AWS. So they have all those capabilities, all those functions. The first screen on top is actually the CloudTrail log, where you can perform queries to search for specific events. Based on those queries, you can create a rule in case this, and this happens, trigger an alert, and there you can say a high alert, a medium alert, or something else. And you can push those alerts towards wherever you want. So it's integratable with a lot of things at this moment. So you can manage your logs centrally in Azure, in AWS. The features are there, actually. So what is our recommendation for that? People also, so that's a gym guy doing things wrong. If I go to the gym, I always start with light weights, and people are looking at me, haha, look at that guy. He has those arms, but he's using light weights, so he's doing things wrong. No, I start with the basics, actually. And that's also something you need to do with security monitoring. If you look at all those incidents that we had, well, if we had identity and access management logging enabled, if we had network flow logging enabled, and if we had system logging enabled, then we actually could create those timelines. So start with those basic logs, validate them, review them, and then you can move on towards the next log ingestion. So start with those basics. And we can detect, so you have seen what the log capabilities are within the cloud. You have seen how we set up centralized monitoring. So how can we automate incident response? Because in most cases, we really need to respond faster. First of all, why should we automate? Well, to increase the efficiency and effectiveness of our incident response process. So here you have the three bullets: people, technology, and processes. In most cases, in a cloud environment, the technology is there, so you can use it. Processes, in most companies, a lot of processes are implemented. Are they implemented in a correct way? Maybe not, but the processes are there. But for a security monitoring team, it's crucial to have sufficient people, and that's always a problem at this moment. So you want to motivate your people, you want to have sufficient people to do actually to do useful stuff and not those repetitive tasks. For example, scrolling down all alerts, all log events. So that's also the reason why you want to automate those incident response processes or those basic scenarios. So a security operations center is always limited in resources, and automation should allow you to detect and respond faster on incidents. And also your security analysts, you want to keep them with you, so they want to do more advanced stuff. They don't want to do those repetitive tasks, so automate those repetitive tasks. You even have, in most cases, incident response playbooks, which are step-by-step guidelines. So if we can describe them in a Word document, why can't we automate them? And where are we going to automate? Well, we, from this research project, we actually focused ourselves on identification and containment. So we want to automate the identification of a specific incident, and we want to contain as fast as possible. All the other steps, in some cases, I still believe there's a manual power required to fully understand the security incident or the impact of that incident. And most organizations are already using automations. I don't know who of you is using sandboxing engines to analyze malware and stuff like that. Not so many, but okay, then we have already two or three people that are using automation. But you have detonation services, sandboxing, Office 365, for example. That's already an automated way of actually analyzing phishing incidents and malware that is coming in via mail. So we have it already. So, demo time. I have a video that's not so good. I don't do it live. Well, the reason for that is actually I asked to our IT department, I'm going to do a demo in Azure, so I want to locally install Azure, and I couldn't get the budget freed up, so that's why I have a demo and a video. First of all, a small introduction about the video or the demo. Automated incident response in Azure. Why we chose Azure? Well, if you look in Google automated incident response in AWS, you get some awesome movies presented at the AWS conferences. And I really recommend you to look at, I've included a link in the presentation, to look at the video below because it's exactly the same scenario that we are going to use in Azure. So it is when a resource gets infected that some actions are automatically triggered. So why Azure? Well, I did the same query in Google again for Azure. The first link was page not found, so I clicked on it, but we are sorry, the page you requested cannot be found. The second one was not really about automation. And the third one was, again, the video I got from AWS, so there was not a lot of information available related to automation and incident response in Azure. So, our demo. What are we going to try? What are we going to achieve today with the demo? We have a corporate network, and we have an application gateway, and we have many servers that are over there listening to users and giving them pages. And those servers, they have an agent installed, and they are actually pushing their logs towards a log analytics workspace. So remember the thing I explained in a couple of slides ago, log analytics workspace, a structured table where all your Windows events are coming into. Well, that's actually what we are doing now with Windows event logs. And on that log analytics workspace, we configured an Azure monitor to monitor those alerts, to see if a specific alert is triggered or not. And via that Azure monitor, we have an automation runbook or an Azure function that is actually triggered. When it sees that a specific alert is there, it's going to validate it and say, okay, you can trigger the following action and you can actually execute that runbook. And within that runbook, we have PowerShell code that will do several things. And we also created an incident response subnet so that we are prepared and ready when the attackers come in. So the scenario here is a user or an adversary drops a malicious file on one of our servers. The server gets compromised, and in our VSOC, the events are forwarded via that agent towards our log analytics workspace. An alert gets triggered, and actually the trigger of that alert will automate the following action. So the automation runbook, PowerShell code is executed. What are we going to do with that specific VM? Well, we are going to isolate it from our production network, and we can going to move it to a different network that is isolated. And there we can also create snapshots. We are going to spin up a SANSIFT workstation for incident for investigations. And you can even go further than that. You can do a lot more things related to incident response. This is just the basics, but we just wanted to show you that it is possible within your cloud environment. So, how did we do it? Well, we actually tested it with four different tools that were available within Azure. So you have automation runbooks, you have Azure functions, you have logic apps, and you have O365 flows. So, looking at the documentation provided by Microsoft, automating incident response is done via logic apps. In our case, it was not working. Why? Well, you see, result failed. The reason behind that was the run is on demand. We couldn't change, actually, to say, okay, automatically when that incident occurred, automatically run that PowerShell script. It's not feasible. You couldn't actually change that setting. And also, when we requested the details of the incident, it's a REST API call that was made. When we requested the details of that incident, there was only one parameter, and it was a serial number that was related to that alert. So I don't know how I can actually automate incident response, but that means that I don't know which resource was infected, so I couldn't also apply any actions on that specific resource. So we need at least a resource ID to actually identify the resource that was attacked. O365 flows is actually more automation in Office 365. So there also you can do REST API calls to the Graph API. And you can execute runbooks over there, but also in that case it failed because we couldn't get the right details. So there also not all fields were populated in that alert, not all fields that we needed to automate that incident response phase or to automate containment were not populated. And then we have automation runbooks and Azure Functions. Well, both of them were successful. So the trigger here was Azure Monitoring. So we created an Azure Monitor alert for both. And the action is different because, yeah, for an automation runbook, you will execute a runbook. And for an Azure function, you will execute an Azure function. What's the difference? It's actually naming convention and a little bit of features that are by default enabled in Azure functions and that you need to manually configure in an automation runbook. For example, the libraries that you need to interact with Azure. With an automation runbook, you need to include them manually. And with Azure Functions, they're actually loaded, they're built-in loaded, so you can already use them. Also, we have some constraints, but the result is still successful. So the alert query is only executed once every 5 minutes. We couldn't go lower than those 5 minutes, meaning that it will look at a period of 5 minutes, and if it sees one alert, or 1,000 alerts, it will be executed only once. So you have to anticipate on that, you have to create a loop and actually look at all those alerts to automate your containment and to say, okay, it was not one alert, it were 5 or 10 alerts. And also, yeah, that's actually passes all alerts in one scheme format, so we needed to parse it. Also for the PowerShell, so PowerShell functions is still in preview mode, meaning it's published, but it's not officially supported yet. And also, there's limited documentation at this moment available for Azure Functions. But again, we strongly believe that that's the way Microsoft is going. So we actually, the demo is based on Azure Functions. We will release both scripts, so automation runbooks and Azure Functions. So take a look at our GitHub in the upcoming weeks. But our demo is now based on the Azure Functions part. So here, you have our Azure environment pre-configured. Let me check that. So yeah, it starts. So what do we have? We have a network security group. We have a virtual network. We have a VM that's running over there. And we are going to look at our log analytics workspace. So the agent is already installed over there. We are just going to take a look. This is your workspace. It's the big chunk of data, of events that's in there. And you can perform queries over there. So what are we going to look for? It even got autocomplete. That's nice. So security alert, where alert severity is high. So if you find a high alert, then it should give you something. In this case, it's very straightforward, but you can even do it with Windows event IDs. Imagine that you install Sysmon, you can look for that specific event ID in your workspace. And here you have the Azure Monitor rule, so you have the query on top that we performed, and there the default period is 30 minutes, we set it to 5 minutes, so it's going to look in a period of 5 minutes if there's one occurrence. Also nice to note that it was $1.50 to run it, so it's going to look for a period within a period of 5 minutes if that alert occurred. And now we are going actually to create an action group on that alert. So if That alert is triggered, then the following action is executed. And what are we going to execute? Well, it's an Azure function, so action type is an Azure function. And there you can fill in the details of that specific Azure function. So there, pay as you go, of course. Then you can actually set up your function app and there your Azure function. So which function he's going to execute. If we click on OK, then that action is actually now integrated within our rule. So we have the rule that detects the security alert and then the action is created. We still need to provide an alert rule name, so high severity alert, because we are monitoring for high severity alerts. And we set it on severity 4 because it's in test phase. And we create that alert rule. So now there is an alert rule monitoring our workspace, and when it gets triggered, the action, the Azure function, is executed. So let's take a look at the function app or the Azure function. So there you have your Azure function. It's serverless code, so you don't know where it runs, but it runs somewhere. But it's the same to Lambda, to AWS Lambda. You can easily do the same with Lambda. And in this case, okay, there's another syntax, but in this case it's PowerShell. So what did we do? First of all, we defined some static variables. We also created the webhook data because, yeah, with the REST API we want to get the data. And we say, okay, once we got the data, then get those details from that specific resource. We created a network security group, a subnet. And actually the new SIFT workstation, so you can create it on the fly and already perform actions also on that workstation. This is also creating a snapshot, so once an alert is triggered, it immediately gets a snapshot of that system so you can investigate it further. And then you have the global function where all functions are actually coupled or tied together. So the network security creation, group creation, the subnet creation, the snapshot creation, so it's all there. So now let's log in. This is one of those five systems. For demo purposes, we didn't configure the application gateway and stuff like that. We are just going to log in locally and trigger an event. So we are going to SSH into that machine with our user on a public IP. Don't configure SSH on a public IP, but okay, for demo purposes, sorry. And there we're actually going to create the ECAR file and execute it. So, and we're going to say, okay, now we are still able to connect towards the internet. So you can see we can reach Google, that server can go outside. The attacker can also push information outside. And within Security Center, we immediately, after it loads, of course, we see it after 5 seconds, but there you see a high severity alert that the ECAR file was detected on that resource, so on that VM01. So we now have a high severity alert that actually is pushed towards our log analytics workspace. And there you can see that our alert rule was triggered. So we got an alert, the high severity alert rule that we created a couple of minutes ago. And there you see that it's fired. It was executed and it did execute the Azure trigger. The trigger function, so the Azure function that we created to move that VMware. So if you go to the details, there you see once again which Azure function was triggered, and it's the security automation PowerShell script move the VMware towards CERT network. So if we refresh it, we see that we have a whole bunch of systems over there, the SIFT workstation, we see that we have a snapshot, we see that we have the CERT subnet that's configured now. And this is the network security group to actually isolate that host. So they are all predefined in PowerShell. You can configure them in PowerShell, in that PowerShell script. So no access is allowed inbound, no access is allowed outbound, only from the SIFT workstation. We have created the snapshot a couple of minutes after the device got infected, or after we detected malicious actions. And you can also see that the VM is now in another subnet. So the virtual network is the same, but the subnet is now the CSearch subnet, so it is within that isolated network. So normally, kaboom, we shouldn't reach Google anymore, or we shouldn't have any internet access anymore. That system is ready for our SOC to be analyzed and cannot further impact production anymore. So our automation script worked. What were the conclusions and the lessons learned from this little project? So, multiple tool sets are available. You saw that we actually investigated four different type of tool sets. The Runbooks, the Azure Functions, we also have the O365 flows. It depends on what you want to achieve. For example, in some cases, you don't want to fully automate that flow. Then you can do it with those Runbooks or those Logic apps. That's actually recommended by Microsoft, because somebody needs to hit a run button before that action gets triggered. Also, another best practice is read the best practices, because there you can already find which type of details are available in specific alerts. We looked at a lot of documentation, and based on Microsoft best practices, we immediately found, okay, these things are not going to work for us. There's a lot of documentation available, and I really recommend you, related to incident response, they have good resources, look at them, and you can definitely find solutions for your organization to do incident response. Train for automation, so there's going to be a new skill set for our security analysts or incident responders. They need to be trained for automation, so they need to be trained on how to automate several stuff. If they are doing 10 times the same things, then probably it's better to automate it. If they are busy 8 hours per day looking at phishing mails and actually contacting users saying, hey, don't click on these links, well, maybe there's another way. Maybe you can try to automate that. Also note that there are extra costs, so you saw that there was $1.50 each time an alert is run. That's indeed an extra cost, but with your SOC analyst, you can now do a lot more things, because a big part of your incident response over here is already automated. Also, the financial damage is limited, because you only have a very limited time window that the attacker can actually move laterally within your environment. Then another fun part, the limitations towards your toolset. So for example, I already mentioned that we installed agents on those servers. So you have in Azure the auto-deploy mode. A funny thing is, if you configure an agent manually, it's activated and logs get ingested within a minute in your security center portal, or in your log analytics workspace, If you select auto deployment, which is recommended by Microsoft, it takes up 4 to 6 hours until that agent is installed. So imagine you are a big financial company, and every time at the end of the year, you have an increase in load, meaning you're going to set up an auto-scale group. So normally you have 3 services running. If you see that the resources are actually consumed more than usual, you're going to say, okay, I will put some additional resources in. I have auto-deployment enabled, meaning, okay, everything is automatically deployed on those new servers. Well, if you have a window of opportunity of 4 to 6 hours that logins, that logs are not actually stored centrally or forwarded centrally, then you already have an issue, because that specific system is vulnerable and the attacker can do whatever he wants because it only has local logs. It's even worse because with autoscale, when your traffic gets normal, those systems are destroyed, so you don't have any logs, you don't have any visibility. So that's why we also recommend to create an initial script that actually deploys the agent manually. You can automate it, but then it's immediately installed and logs are immediately forwarded. And preview mode means bugs. The first time we created the alert rule, we created it, it said successfully created, but we never saw it in our dashboard. And we were like, okay, what is going on? Stupid thing, but we were using Mozilla Firefox. And if you opened it with Internet Explorer, of course it worked. So there are still some bugs. Also, preview mode, they now released Sentinel. There are also bugs related to that product a little bit. So in preview mode, you cannot really expect that everything works perfectly. Additionally, we're going to release a series of blog posts. So there are already 3 blog posts released related to security monitoring in cloud environments. And also the scripts we used, they need to be cleaned up a little bit. I'm not the best coder. I'm actually not really a good coding guy. So they are really ugly, so we need to clean them up. And a colleague of mine who is really good at incident automation and automation in general is actually taking a look to more dynamically create those scripts. But we are going to release them in the upcoming weeks. And I think, I'm actually within my time. I think that's it for me. So I want to thank you, and I hope you have learned something and it was interesting. So, are there any questions? We have still 9 minutes, so. Sorry, can you repeat that? Because
I said, in your example, are the like the IR environment and the
production
are they in different accounts, or would it be in the same account in a different VPC?
Yeah. So that's actually a good question. So I will repeat it once again. So the accounts that we use for example, the CERT network or the production network, are they different or are that the same account? So there you have several options, and in our case it were different accounts. So we are using resource groups, and with resource groups you can say, okay, that group is responsible for that particular resource set, meaning that you can define the CERT is responsible for the CERT network, so they can do whatever they want within limits, of course, but they can do whatever they want within that CERT subnet. And production network is actually managed by IT operations, and they can configure over there. So the separation of duties over there also, it's configured, and we defined it actually like that. I don't know if that's a clear answer on your question. Yeah? You're welcome. Other questions? Now we have 7 minutes to drink more beer. I actually don't drink beer this time of the year, but yeah, perfect. Also an excellent question. Ah, you're good in questions. No, so that was actually a live change on the system. So it was not a snapshot, and then we actually reverted it towards the CERT network. No, it was actually the live system that was just with PowerShell. We changed the network configuration settings via API calls, and there we actually said, okay, you are now part of the other network, so pull it out of the network and put it in another network. So you can also do it with snapshots and destroy the machine and then actually spin up the snapshot in a CERT network. But in this case, it was really a live migration of that system. The same can be done in AWS with Lambda, where you can actually do, Lambda is the equivalent of Azure Functions. So there you can also state, okay, if that happens with my machine, pull it out from the network and put it in a more monitored network. You can even create other resources to do initial monitoring. You can create a network tab to actually look at the flows that are ongoing between those systems. So it's actually more observe, orient, and act on live traffic, to be honest. So now we have 5 minutes, so that means we can still, sorry. Well, that's a very good question, and that's so I will repeat that question. How big is the risk of a denial of service? So meaning that if you have a lot of false positives, you are going to do automated actions, meaning that you can denial of service yourself, of course. In this case, if you have specific alerts, so for this specific case, it's not really a risk. Why? Because you can also say, imagine that I have 5 servers. Those 5 servers, they have the same configuration, they have the same application running. I can even say when I pull out one device, spin up one from the golden image, meaning that not a compromised system is actually spin up with the golden configuration state. But to be honest, there are cases where you can indeed lock yourself out or perform a denial of service. If all your systems, imagine that you have a very big vulnerability in your application and all your systems are attacked, yeah, immediately those automated actions, they will pull down all those systems and you will get a situation where systems are spinned up again based from a golden image, but the attacker re-attacks again, and then yeah, you have a loophole. So it is possible. However, I think the risk is minimized if you create good alert rules stating if this specific event occurs, then actually do this. But it's a very good question, and indeed it's also what you hear a lot if you say, okay, we can automate incident response, that clients are hesitating or people, security analysts are hesitating, should I apply this or not? But a very good question. Other questions? Yes. Multi-cloud applications, that's a good one. That's a very good one. So multi-cloud applications, we actually recently did a study about how to combine multiple clouds and do security monitoring on those multiple cloud environments, and it depends on the type of cloud you are consuming. So is it a software as a service? Then yeah, it's depending in most cases on the contract that you have and which interfaces that you have with those cloud providers. But imagine that you have AWS and that you have Azure, meaning you have features to increase monitoring and increase visibility. We actually think or believe that if you create virtual CSOCs within those environments, that's beneficial. Why? Because you're going to use threat intel from those providers. You can use their toolset that is specifically built for those cloud environments. And you can even, because it's based on web application protocols, so you can even, with the REST APIs, you can even integrate it with one central SIEM solution, where you say, okay, forward me all those alerts, so that you can immediately go to the direct cloud and see, okay, what is the impact? Are there links between my multiple cloud environments? It's the same for identity and access management. For example, if you have AWS and if you have Azure, we see that developers are using two accounts. It's actually quite easy to integrate, for example, Azure AD within AWS so that you have central authentication platform. So it's the same a little bit with cloud environments. Now you have the cloud native SIEM that is recently released, but Sentinel, it also has an adapter for AWS, so you can there also, you can integrate it. But from our point of view, if you have a very large environment, I think the best approach is to build virtual CSOCs in every cloud environment and handle the log events there, create and configure the alert rules there based on the tools that you have available in that cloud environment, combine it with threat intel they gather, and then actually forward your alerts towards a centrally managed dashboard so that you only have to monitor one dashboard, but you can still have the benefit of all those cloud features. But again, that's a personal view also. There are other ways to do that. I don't know if anybody has experience with multiple cloud environments and logging. Good experiences. No. Me too. So yeah, I'm on time, so thank you for your questions. And thank you very much for attending my talk.